Okay, so this one is a better one, not like the statistics one. So how to write a great thesis? Conflict of interest, none. So I believe thesis is our first exposure to research to most of our medical students. In undergraduate level, we have been taught something in PSM, but it hardly brushes our brain. So thesis, I believe, is the first exposure where we are actually in pursuit of knowledge. Before that, we are just consuming knowledge. We are not producing anything. This is our first effort where we can also add to the knowledge pool. And we are exposed to scientific methods. We are exposed to things of research. It all depends on your guide and your infrastructure. But in our place, our students are made to realize that research is a way of life. And there are a lot to research in medical practice as well as in our daily life. Thesis, well, it depends on your guide, depends on your institute, infrastructure that the institute provides, and most importantly, it depends on you. So you have to be really up to the mark for that. Tips for great thesis, I've just compiled it from a lot of personal experience, comments from theses that are returned from university, and reading and correcting a lot of theses of my students. So tip one is selecting topic. I think few of these things are repetitions, but I'll just go through it fast. You need to avoid selecting a controversial topic. This is your first exposure to research. You're not trying to do a randomized trial, and you're not trying to reach the apex of the pyramid to begin with. Start small, start something simple, okay? Start with a case control study, or start with a cohort one. Subject that you know about or you like most in orthopedics, don't try to take thesis which is very vast. Restrict to a topic, keep it simple. Go through the previous thesis papers of your university, of your own institute. So before we move on to selecting topics, we have been exposed to the keywords. These keywords are important in literature review, but these are also important in structuring your thesis. If they are defined by the topic of your study, and they are termed as PICO. So a lot has been said about this. It's population, intervention, control, and outcome measure. If you arrange your thesis according to the PICO format, most of the format will fall into place. So keep the keywords in mind. This will help you from the beginning till the end of your thesis. We take an example. For example, we want to study, is there a difference between conventional and high flexion total knee replacement in terms of functional outcome? So if you take the PICO format for that question, the patient is total knee replacement, intervention is high flexion, control is conventional group, and outcome is the functional outcome. So that's the PICO format. If you look at another study where you just want to do a case study of FAI and the surgical outcome, so that just the patient and intervention becomes your PICO format. So how to select the topic? Most of the time the topic is given to us for our thesis, but you can just go through it so you can teach your juniors and the next rung. So how to select? Zero down technique. Step one, select a broad area. Broad area of specialty, for example, trauma, arthroplasty. So whatever you feel in first 1 or 2 months of your, or whatever you want to give to your junior, give him a broad topic. That becomes your first keyword. Step two, discuss with your seniors. Discuss which work is more. Is arthroplasty more, trauma more, or spine is not done in your institute, so you can't do a spine paper. Which subspecialty cases are more? For example, if arthroscopy is done, is it knee arthroscopy, shoulder, or elbow, or any other case that has been done more in your institute? So it depends on what you are having, what cases you are having at your institute. The same thing applies to sample size. It always depends on what cases you have at your institute. Feasibility has to be checked. So this is your second keyword. So discuss with your seniors. For example, if your first keyword is knee arthroplasty, your senior can give you, you can study a cruciate retaining, substituting, something like that. In that range, he can give you some guidance. Or if your first keyword is spine, he can tell you to do it on scoliosis, spondylolisthesis. So these are the cases that are most commonly seen in your institute. So select that as your second keyword. So this also defines the feasibility of the study. Your second keyword. Step three, with the two keywords, go to your guide. Okay, up till now you have not approached your guide. Go and discuss with him, saying that you want to do something in this area. You want to do something with high flexion knee arthroplasty, or you want to do something in spine scoliosis. He'll provide you another keyword. He wants you to look at idiopathic scoliosis, or he wants you to look at functional outcome between high flexion and conventional. So that gives you a third keyword. So your guide is your source for third keyword. With these three keywords, you go to the literature. You review literature, search for last 1 year papers with these keywords, 10 to 12 papers, read the abstract, according to your judgment, select one or two of them, or even four or five of them. Take those topics or those four or five papers to your guide again. This will be full articles. So you take to them, take to him, he'll select probably one of them or two of them, or tell you that this is what the rough guideline is. So that topic becomes your template paper. The concept of keywords and template paper is very important for your thesis. This will help you all along. So that becomes your template paper. For example, in our case, where we took TKR, high flexion comparison with the standard implant, I put the keywords here in PubMed search, and I got 20-25 results, and I go through the abstract, take one of the papers or two of the papers to my guide, and he says, okay, this one is good for you. The title of this paper is good for you, and that becomes your template paper. So tip two is selecting your template paper carefully. It's also called as mother article and things like that. There are various names that are given to it, but it will act as a second guide for you. So even if your guide is not available, this template paper will help you throughout your thesis. Helps you understand the current status, because the discussion is there, introduction is there. You need the full text of the template paper. It helps you planning the study. So you plan a study which is similar to it. So mind you, this is your thesis. You're not trying to do something very new. This, you are trying to just understand the research methods and the concept about it. Okay. So a lot of questions about template paper. The study is already done, so why you want to do it again? For any study to come into print, at least 3 to 4 years of data collection is needed. So for example, a study is published today, it has around 3-4 years of data collection, and along with that 1 year in publication. So it already 4 years have passed for the study. And when you are starting the study now, and when you are going to publish, will be another 4 years. So the gap between the studies will be almost 8 years. So there is significant gap between you and the template paper. Also, there will be a lot of other things. For example, he is looking at some other outcomes or something else. For example, this study is 3 years post-op. Data collection goes on for 5 years for this. Also, this is from South Korea. So we are doing an Indian study. So geographical difference also applies. So the study is similar to it, but not the same. So don't worry about people telling you that this is already done. Why do you want to do it again? This is the rationale for that. In cases where topic is already given to you, you identify the keywords in PICO format, write those keywords and do a review of literature and find your template paper. This is the most easy thing to find it. Keywords, template paper, and most of your thing is done. So now you have topic, you have keywords, and you have template paper. Of course, you have your guide. Let's see how we utilize the concept of keywords and the template paper in a title. For example, this is an example that we are taking. Prospective comparison of high flexion and standard TKR. Does the functional outcome differ? So that's the study design, prospective comparison, that's the study population, that's the outcome measure, and that's the hypothesis. So the title itself tells you everything about the study and includes the keywords and includes all the concepts. Tip three is clear research question and correct research methodology. I think a lot have been spoken about it. So you have to define your research methodology, whatever you're doing, retrospective, prospective. Don't write retrospective come prospective study. There is nothing like that. It is either retrospective or prospective. So you need to define your aims and objective. So most of the students will write their objective, which is just the differential of their aim. So make some segregation from your aim. So research methodology, you have to select and write it accordingly. Inclusion and exclusion criteria is something where everybody makes a mistake. For example, in our study, we want to include on primary TKR. By corollary, all students will write that they will exclude all revision TKRs. That's not correct. Your sample is, your screening population here is TKRs, okay, primary TKR. So your exclusion criteria is from that sample. So from the primary TKRs, you want to exclude something where primary is done for, say, malunion, or primary has extra articular deformities, or it's a complex primary. So you want to take a simple primary, exclude a complex. Don't exclude something that is completely excluded anyways. So be selective about that. Tip three is outcome measure. Now, outcome measure is one of the most important part of your statistical as well as the methodology part. So primary outcome measure is the most important outcome. For example, in our case, knee range of motion would be the most important primary outcome. So this will help you in calculating sample size. So when you are doing the review of literature for sample size, you do the review only for the primary outcome. If there are two equal primary outcomes, you can take a mean of that, but most of the time we'll have just one primary and two or three secondary outcomes. Now, outcome measures have to be valid. So you need to do a literature review, see if they are valid. They have to be reliable. So valid in your population and in your language. So that too also you have to study. Template paper will help you a lot in selecting the outcome measures. So you can select whatever the template paper has, plus one or two as per your own situation. So outcome measures can be divided into four. Clinical, which is assessed by the clinician, range of motion, pain. Clinical scores, which is again assessed by the surgeon. So surgeon asks the questions to the patient and he gives an answer. Patient reported outcome is separate from the clinical scores. So for example, WOMAC score and Knee Society score are different. Knee Society has two components, one in knee score and function score. The function score part is patient reported, while the knee score part is clinician reported. So these two are different. And then lastly is quality of life. I suggest all of you include all four of these outcome measures in your thesis, so it will be helpful for you to analyze and also in your future project. Tip five is sample size calculation. I think this is highly overrated. But a lot of theses are coming back stating that please mention your sample size calculation. I think most of the guides have, or reviewers have just attended some workshop and they have heard the word and that's why they are sending it back. But like I told you, there are two softwares, WinPepi and Primer, and you can do easily sample size calculation. Even your statistician can tell you how to do it. Clearly mention the method that you have used and what review article you have used. You can use your template article for calculating the sample size also. So template article is working at every phase of your thing. Add 10% as attrition. So whatever sample size you get, add 10% to it in terms of dropouts and other things. So your sample size become more strong. Sixth is review of literature. You need to follow the keywords. So start from the most broad keyword, knee arthroplasty, and then go on becoming more and more specific till you reach the question that you are looking at. So divide your review of literature section into various chapters. So chapter one will be on knee arthroplasty, the first keyword, historical aspects. Two will be on conventional, review of functional outcome. Three will be high flexion knee, review of functional outcome. And fourth will be actually your title. So comparison of high flexion and conventional prosthesis, current literature review. So you divide your review of literature section into four sections. This is guided by your keywords. Resources for review are PubMed and Google. PubMed directly gives you a search builder. So this is search builder. You just put your keywords here. These are your fields and Boolean operators here. Click search and you get the most relevant articles. Google search and Google Scholar is a bit tricky, but still, for example, if your thesis is on torticollis in adults and you do a Google search, it will give you a lot of websites. It will not give you specific things. So what you do is add the word PubMed to it and it will start giving you specific articles. You scroll down, find an article which is relevant to your scenario. This article is from India and probably it is more relevant to your thesis. Select it as a template article. Go to cited article. This will give you articles published after the template. So these are recent ones. And you can go to related articles, which give you all review of literature from Google Scholar. So Google Scholar and PubMed combined together will give you almost 97% of literature review. Don't need to go on any other database. If you click on the title of the article, it will take you to PubMed. There you can get another list on the related citation article. So you get another list while clicking see all. So Google add PubMed to the key phrase, select most relevant related article, cited article and PubMed. So Google and PubMed will combine together, will finish your literature review. You'll get four lists from the PubMed keyword, from PubMed related, Google cited. So all four lists you can go through and snowball your literature review. You need to select what is relevant. Once you have this full text article, what do you do with them? You put them into an Excel sheet, okay? So this Excel sheet has a lot of parameters like author, year, journal, hypothesis, number of patients, all the variables that are in those papers, just put them here. So article 1, all the variables here. Article 2, all the variables here. So you don't have to go back again and read the articles again. Once you have this, over a period of 1 or 2 years, the writing of introduction, writing of discussion becomes very, very easy. I do this even for my papers. So it takes time, but once you have it, you can easily write anything about that subject. And you don't have to read the papers again. Second good tip is use Mendeley. Now Mendeley is a software which has web-based, cloud-based, also desktop, and also in mobile app. Now this is the web-based version of it, where there is a web importer. It acts as a plugin to your browser here. So whenever I'm doing a literature review, for example, I'm doing it in PubMed, I can directly add all the reviewed articles here and add it to my Mendeley account. So it goes to my library and gets added, all the articles get added to that, only the abstracts. If the full text is available, it will extract the full text from PubMed. So it will give you all the articles. So few of them are full text, few of them are abstracts. This is my Mendeley library online. This is a desktop version of Mendeley, which again syncs with the web version. So all the articles on the web version also available on the desktop version. In the desktop version, I can add a lot of PDF from my computer. So I can, if I am doing a review on distal femur non-union, I have a lot of PDFs there. I can directly add it to Mendeley account. The good thing about adding all the PDFs at one place is I can open these PDFs whenever I want in Mendeley itself. I can anoint them, I can add comments to it and save them with the annotations and all the comments. The other important point of Mendeley is it works as a citation manager. Especially for thesis, this is very important. So you have to install this MS Word plugin. Once you install this, Mendeley will be available on MS Word. So it will be available under the reference tab of it. Once you click on reference, it will open as insert citation. For example, if I want to insert citation here, so I want to put a reference number here, I'll just take the cursor there, click on insert citation. It will take me to Mendeley. I click on go to Mendeley. I can select whatever citation I want to take from here. For example, I want to select this one. I select it, add cite, and it automatically asks me for which format. I select this one, and it has added this citation. And it can add the bibliography at the end of your thesis. So this is automatic. Anytime you change the order of references, this get updated automatically. So for example, you have written half of a thesis, 1 to 60 are already being numbered, but your guide asks you to add few more in between. So you don't have to change the numbers again if you're using Mendeley. You can easily add them, numbers will change automatically. So it's a good citation manager also. Mendeley is available as a mobile app. Important thing about this is that it syncs. So all the articles that are there come to your mobile app also. You can read the full text, PDF, do annotation. So it is easy for review of it. Seventh tip is statistics. Now, I've taken already a lecture on it, but you need to have a statistical method at the end of your material method. So describe what you're going to do. Simply mention what variables, what test, and a statistician checklist that I showed in the last lecture. Writing results, present data sequentially, follow the keywords. So keyword format you can follow in review of literature, in results, also in discussion. Use tables and graphs liberally. I think this we have covered in some part. So first result is about the complete TKR group. Second is about the conventional TKR. Third is about the high flexion. And the last one is about the comparative result. So organize your results also in the same format. Lastly, add complications. So always add complications to your results. When writing your results, mention mean plus standard deviation and range always. You can replace range with confidence intervals, but for your thesis, range is good enough. Whenever you're writing percentage, write in this format. Mention the actual numbers also. Don't write just percentages. So this is again the same thing. You need to organize along with as per your keywords. Don't describe methods in your results. For example, don't again say that these are randomized and things like that. Don't describe about statistical test again. These are part of your material methods. Improper presentation of p-value is very common. Don't just give less than 5 or more than 5. You have to mention it exact value till 3 decimal places. This is just examples. So you need to mention them. Don't just mention non-significant or this is the correct way of putting it. Making inferences or conclusion. Don't discuss your results in your result section. The entire discussion section is for that. So don't just start discussing it there. Okay? These are very common pitfalls that we see in a lot of theses. So presenting partial results, this is an ethical issue. A lot of students will take out the bad results, keep only the good ones, and then analyze and send the results. It's an ethical problem, but nevertheless. Discussion, you need to divide them into parts. Introduction, body, strength and limitation, and conclusion. It has to be short and context. The first paragraph, summarize your result, answer the question that were raised in the introduction. This is the body of it. You need to support your findings, compare with context of literature, explain how your study will add value, and discuss the reason for differences. Strength and limitation has to be mentioned in your discussion as a separate paragraph. This is a checklist where you can, I'll give this presentation if you want, so you can follow this checklist. Step 10 is the format, standard format of a university, you should know and follow that format. Don't overinterpret your data. And finally, the four deadly sins, data manipulation, falsification, plagiarism, and ethical issues. So you have to be always ethically strong whenever you're doing a thesis. So you don't have to do something very innovative or otherwise. You need to do a simple thing, but do it truthfully. Thesis will always be there with you. It is your moral, social, and scientific responsibility, and it's a measure of your integrity. So be careful about that. Again, words are at premium and they are limited by readers' attention. You need to think about reviewers and your guide's perspective. Sometimes your perspective and your guide's perspective can be totally different. So you need to always think about what your guide will say, what your reviewer will say, and give it sufficient time. Don't hurry up in the last 4 months or 6 months. Keep it a sequential process from the beginning. You're trying to create something that is timeless. You're going to publish this, and any publication is a time capsule. So you need to give it enough time for it to nurture and grow. Thank you.